Welcome everybody to Talking Geek. I am your host, Aaron. We are here for season 4, episode 2, and I am here with my guest co-host, Sam, from LFG Cyber Cafe. How you doing, man?
Doing good. Doing good. Another beautiful day in paradise.
Exactly, as it's still hot in San Antonio.
Yes, it is. We had like 3 good cold days, and now we're back to, you know, high 90s. It's the way it is.
It is. It's not going to go anywhere. We're just going to stay hot. We get our mild summer, essentially, right now. So I just want, what do you do, man? Like here, I know you own LFG Cyber Cafe, so tell us a little bit about that first.
Yeah, so I'm one of the co-owners of LFG Cyber Cafe, so really it's just like a modern day arcade. Instead of, you know, some arcade cabinets, we have high performance gaming PCs, consoles, virtual reality systems, things like that. So just a communal place for people to come in and, you know, if they don't have the necessary hardware for some of the new stuff or they just want to experience PC gaming with their friends, a place to do that together.
Nice, that's good. And you know, hopefully COVID's not killing it too bad right now.
Yeah, wouldn't say they're doing us, you know, because the business is classified as an arcade, you know, the arcades were almost completely, I mean, they were completely closed when the announcement was first made. So, you know, that definitely didn't feel great.
Yeah,
and
exactly.
It's still not feeling great, but, you know, we'll find our way. We're going to be okay.
You got this. You'll be good. So on today's show, we have our segments. Normally we have Would You Rather. We're going to have some of the videos. I'm going to talk about those that came out this week, as well as some game news and some stuff about esports this week, guys. So hopefully y'all can enjoy and, you know, just get a chill with us now that we got Sam in office, because Robert somehow got out of his blood-written contract that I made him sign for at least another, what, week, I think he comes back,
another
or 2 weeks?
He's enjoying the cold weather
in Chicago. Chicago or Wisconsin, because I think Kristen said something about Wisconsin. I don't know. So our first segment, which I don't know if you've ever seen, it's called Would You Rather. So we basically have, I don't even know where I put the stuff now. So we have a book that, you know, we just ask a question, would you rather X, Y, or Z, or I have a little envelope, I guess you could say. It's, I don't know. A little bag.
Okay.
That, I don't know where you got the baggie from, Aaron.
Look, Raul on the corner said it was okay. All right.
It's not even enough to fit a sandwich. I don't even know what you would put in there. Like 6 carrots, little baby ones.
So my kid uses them for school sometimes. Those little goldfish things, she puts like a handful, and her hands are tiny, so it works perfectly.
Using kids as a scapegoat.
Yes.
Sure.
We're going to go with that. So you get a pick. Do you want me to ask you a question from the book or one of the random more geeky kind of ones from that little bag?
What I define geeky.
We talk so
about
it's
like
gonna
the whole
be,
realm of geek?
Oh, yeah. So it could be comic book, movies, video games, movies,
we'll
TV.
Go with the geek one. You all know, right. I don't follow all of the culture probably as well as I should.
Would you like to pick it yourself?
No.
I'm pick it.
Okay. You do the honors.
We right, don't know what's see. Been in that baggie, bro.
That's right. It's on your hands now.
Dang it. I'm going to go bleach my hands after this, guys, for, you know, no reasons. All right. This is actually not a bad one. Would you rather be John Wick or Riddick?
Definitely John Wick.
John Wick? Okay.
Yeah, you know, Riddick, just like living in the realm of Riddick, the idea of like aliens A, existing, and B, also being like super vigilant people murderers. you know, I would rather be killing my own kind than have to worry about an outside source that I don't fully understand.
That's true. That's true.
Yeah,
okay.
And a cool dog. So, you know, that goes a long way, I think, in terms
of like...
But the
dog dies.
Yeah, but until he died, he got to, you know, share a good... That's what life's
well,
all about.
It depends on which dog you're thinking is cool, because the pit bull's still alive.
Oh, yeah. He gets a pit bull at the end of the first one. Right. Or second one? Second one?
The first one was a pit bull.
Oh, okay.
Moral of the story is, he's got some companionship.
That is true.
I'm definitely going to double down with John Wick, for sure.
That is true, so...
And everybody loves Keanu now.
They really do, everybody, especially...
He's popping off, dude. Cyberpunk, like, that's...
Oh, God.
Yeah.
You're all amazing, or what was it, you all are awesome or something, he would say. I was like, yeah, I love him.
Stop it, Keanu, our hearts.
Right?
Our hearts. We're Team Keanu, right?
Right? All right, Frank, you next. Which one do you want?
I'll go with Riddick.
Riddick? Okay.
Because I've been shot at. It's not fun.
It's not fun.
It's not fun.
I mean, Riddick also gets shot at, so are you really trading any of
it? It's a lot easier to see a laser coming than it is a bullet.
That's true. Yeah,
that's fair. All right.
I mean, I got to go with you on this one, Sam. I think I would go John, especially because you get the dog. You do. You're right. I got to give you the dog. You're right.
You may lose the dog, but you get.
Hey, Riddick has a dog too. It's an alien dog, but it's a dog. Now his dog died.
That's true.
That's true.
But then I got a lot of money as John. I mean, a lot of money. Even though everything's like a gold coin for whatever reason.
Well,
but
right. And Riddick is essentially like a escaped prisoner?
Something, yeah. He got no money.
He did become like a king, and he did get a lot of booty. So I was good on that.
I mean,
I don't know. I feel like they both get some booty.
I mean, that's true.
Vin Diesel, Keanu Reeves, you're probably killing that game either which way you cut.
All right, so I guess we'll do mine, but I'll do mine from the bag too. I'll pick my own so you don't have to put your hand in the bag.
Incriminate myself.
Yeah, exactly.
I appreciate that.
You're welcome. I'm glad I could help you. So. Okay, so mine is, would you rather be a Sith Lord or a Jedi Master? I'm going to go Sith Lord. I like the red. I like red. And I'm sure, and at this point, I'm going to still argue, they have to have good dismemberment insurance by now. They really do, because, I mean, how many of them lose limbs at this point?
A lot, yeah.
So, I would go Sith. What about you?
I think I would also go Sith. I'm a huge proponent for the bad guys. I don't know, you know, I think Power Rangers kind of started that for me. Like you
Green
had,
Ranger?
Well, no, or? like you had the costumes, because I grew up with Power Rangers.
Yeah.
You had all of the Power Rangers in their, like, spandex, and then you had these, like, super ornate, elaborate costumes for the villains, and I kind of, like, I kind of fell in love with that, because the villains always looked cooler, in my opinion, than the Power. Like, they always lost, but they got to look cool doing it. Right, yeah. Right.
Exactly. What about you, Frank?
I'm going to go Sith, bro.
Sith. So we're all Sith Lords here.
Wow. Yeah.
Yeah.
Power to Jedi Sith rolled a donut. Sorry, guys.
Exactly. Frank, what do you want? You want to try one? You want the book or you want the bag?
See the book.
So... See what you're going to pick. You're not going to pick like the drowning and fire one like Robert did to you. Don't pick the fire one though this time. Well, while you're doing that, I'll actually throw this out together too. Because it's going to take you a minute to find what I'm thinking, right? Or do you already see one? He's picking. So don't forget to check out our other videos, guys, this week. So we do have Get Your Ghost On Month. This is where we do all of our haunted movies. All of our haunted investigations where I go out with some other groups and we do like Comanche Lookout Point. We've done Victoria Black Swan Inn and we've done some other ones. This week is Victoria Black Swan Inn. We also have our Aftermath show that Peter will be on that you'll be able to check out at Official GYGO. That's on YouTube or Facebook, wherever you want to watch it, guys. It will be there. And definitely check that out. And I think what else comes out this week? Well, of course, this show. Oh, our interview with the doctor. I forgot. I cannot pronounce names, so I'm not even going to butcher her name, but her name will be right here. But we'll call her the doctor, so that way the Daleks know where she's at. And check out that interview this week, guys. Really nice talking to her. Peter got to talk with her, and we did a little interview with her about all her monster stuff. So go check that stuff out as well, guys.
Cool.
What do you got?
I found, would you rather be buried alive or painfully poisoned?
Again? Really? You and Robert. Oh my gosh. I hate y'all. So which one is it, Frank, for you?
I would probably want to be painfully poisoned.
Okay. See, this is what I deal with when it comes to him and Robert now.
He sought that out. That was orchestrated. That was not an accident.
No, it really was.
It wasn't like...
I put my finger on it, and then I had to choose between that one or... rather have a steak dinner or a seafood platter.
Okay.
You could have gone with that.
Boring.
It's a little boring.
There's two pages, guys, that he can look at.
Okay. Would you rather make snowmen or snow angels?
Okay, you got me.
That's
never mind.
That's pretty cute. I'm a snowman.
Yeah, I'd say snowman, too. Because at least the snowman I could push on somebody later.
And you don't get the snow, like, in the back of your coat from laying down, you know?
That is true. That is true.
Nobody enjoys that.
So, I mean, I have to agree with you. I think I would take painfully poisoned over... I saw that movie with Ryan Reynolds where he was buried alive. And I forgot the name of the movie. But, nah, I don't want to do that. I'll just take the painfully poisoned.
Hard pass.
Yeah.
It takes, you know, you're going to be lit in there for like a week.
Yeah. If you're lucky. I mean, you last a week maybe.
That's assuming that the box is airtight. Otherwise, you just breathe through the soil. And you're down there waiting.
Yeah, because it's like, what, 5 days that the body can go without water or something like that?
I think it's 7 without water, yeah.
Yeah, so then you'll still be dead. What about you? Which would you pick?
Yeah, definitely. Just poison me, please.
Poison me. Take me out. I'll take the pain.
Poison, yeah, please. Couldn't possibly last that long. Unless it's like a 7-day poison, in which case, I don't know.
At that point, though, if it's a 7-day poison, I'll take blowfish and any other food that could poison me and kill me quicker.
True.
And then just be done with it.
No, it would be like stonefish. You get the one that lasts like 3 weeks.
Oh. I don't know.
Yeah, it's true.
See, look, we've got two questions.
Well, that depends on where you are. Like, you know, if I'm in Maine, I'm not going to be getting the steak in Maine. I'll be getting the seafood platter, right? But in Texas...
You got to go for that steak.
You're going to go for the steak.
Yeah. I've had so many bad experiences with lobster in Texas. Whoa. I'm like, I need to get out of here and try it again.
Where is that lobster coming from? Because it's probably not coming from the Gulf. And even if it is, pretty sure lobsters are a bottom feeder. And
you got, yeah. Like,
petroleum. They're just nomming on oil down my there. Gosh.
So I had an ex. She's actually from up north. She's from Montana. But her family was originally from Maine. And she was like, oh, let's go get lobster. And I was like, cool. So we went to, what was it, like, Red Lobster or something.
Oh, fancy.
Yeah, we went fancy.
Skip the papados. It was like Red Lobster. Yeah.
Pinky out and everything when you're drinking, you know? We went and the lobster just tastes like seawater. That's all it was. And she was like, she calls her grandpa. She goes, Grandpa, why does it taste like seawater? He's like, oh, they don't know how to cook it. That's why. They're dumb. I was like, what do you mean? Well, if you cook it too long, it's going to taste like seawater. If you cook it not enough, well, you know, blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, oh, well, yeah, it's in Texas. What do you expect? It's not on a grill. They don't know what to do.
That's right. That's mostly right.
So, you know, moving to our next one, I want to talk a bunch of gaming news, especially because we have you here. So the first thing I want to talk about, because, you know, I know you guys do tournaments over at LFG Cafe. Mm-hmm. What do you think about Steve and Alex coming from Minecraft to Super Smash Brothers first? What's your opinion on that?
I mean, business-wise or, like, the way I feel about Minecraft kind of, like, bridging over into Nintendo?
Let's go with the Minecraft bridging Nintendo, because this opens a big door for Microsoft now.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's great, right? Like, is it a character that deserves place over some of other characters in, like, Nintendo's heritage? Probably not.
Yeah.
But from, like, a marketing side, how do you refute that, like, that's a win for everybody involved, all things considered? Like,
exactly.
There's definitely characters that would have been cooler to see, but I can't, you know, being a business owner, like, that makes complete sense.
Yeah.
It was a very smart move, in my opinion.
Yeah, I mean, that's what I think. I mean, now that it comes out October 13th, I think, is the release date for it. So, yeah, now you're really bitching that, like, hey, we're shaking each other's hands, we're working together. Oh, and look at Sony over there not wanting to play nice. I mean, because you know Microsoft's eventually going to, like, poke at them somehow.
Yeah, it's so, coming. It's coming.
So do you think, because I'm assuming you've had, have you all had tournaments there for Smash Brothers before?
Mm-hmm.
So do you think this is going to change up a lot of the playstyle maybe? Or do you think right now it's too soon to tell?
Yeah, I mean, with FGCs a lot of times, like, there's balancing. Like, a new character comes out, you know, depending on the developer, are they actually doing any competitive testing? Do they have people that play at a professional level kind of playing with the character and getting a feel for it to see how it's going to, like, change the meta or, you know, how they're going to be utilized in the game. I don't know what their strategy is there, but, like, if you look at Riot's just like, yeah, this guy looks great, and they just throw it into League of Legends, and then, you know, everyone's MMR tanks for a couple weeks, and then they nuke them, and they get them recalibrated. It could go either way. He could be super overpowered, like Bayonetta from, you know...
oh, gosh, I forgot about her.
Yeah, or he could just be subpar. I don't know. I guess we'll see.
Yeah, and one thing, I don't know if you watched, like, the little press release they did with it. He even comments that they're all still at home, so they really haven't had a big chance to play test against each other like they normally would if they were in office. So I am curious, like, how is it going to change anything? Is it going to just be some really underpowered character or some overpowered one? Because, like you said, you can't balance if you're just at home. Like, okay, we made the character. Good luck. See what happens. Right.
Yeah. I mean, they have, like, the online lobbies, but like I said, like, you know, Bayonetta coming out of Smash Ultimate, like, for the Wii U, that was a complete shift in the way that she functioned and the way that she moved. So I haven't seen his moveset. Like, that's not what I follow. But it could very well turn out that, you know, he does dominate online because of just the net code. But then on live play, you know, it's different because you can kind of, like, count the frames and kind of prepare for it.
Exactly. So, and I know, I love how you did comment that it's Minecraft or Microsoft's essentially like, hey, let's be friends kind of thing. Do you think, do you think there could be other ones from Microsoft coming out? Like, could we see Master Chief, you think? Or what is your opinion on that, honestly? Do you think this is, like, that first we're going to start getting other people?
I don't know if I don't know how far that strategy will run.
Yeah.
It could go really far. I mean, they could go as far to say, like, you know, bringing in Gordon from Half-Life to bridge the PC and Valve thing, and that would be ridiculous. They could go anywhere with it. Do they continue to do it? Probably. It just depends on, you know, where is that dollar coming from? Are they doing it so that people pay for the pass to get these new characters, and then they're reaching out to other organizations that, you know, people would otherwise be fond of? If that's the case, then Master Chief makes complete sense. Like, that is a very natural transition. If they're not, and they're really just trying to kind of, like, meet out PlayStation and kind of push them behind the curve, you know, they're gonna drive that nail, I think, as hard as they can, for sure.
Makes sense. Yeah, and that's what I'm thinking, because, like, that was my first thought. It's like, okay, so when's Master Chief or, you know, one of the guys from Gears, like Marcus, Dom, or even the Locust, like, any of them gonna come out?
But isn't there a character from Persona?
Ooh, do they have one from Persona?
Yeah, isn't Joker from Persona? Because that's a PlayStation title.
That is right. You're right. Because Joker came out last year?
Yeah. And I don't know if that was originally on Nintendo, because that's not a game that, you know, I play or have played. But I know that, you know, that was a PlayStation game. Am I wrong?
So I don't know much on Persona. That's one of the ones when I heard Joker was coming out. Who the heck? And I had to look it up, and I'm like, oh, I don't play.
It was like
game.
A Vita title. Persona was for sure. I know that much because my best friend, my business partner, actually has a Vita, and we played it on vacation. So
nice.
Yeah. So I don't know. Maybe this isn't something so outside the realm of normalcy. You know, people just are excited that it's Steve and not something else.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, that could be true too. Because I mean, it's I saw it and I was just kind of like. Minecraft? Out of all things, I mean, this thing game's been around for, what, years now, hasn't it? Like,
yeah, but think about how many kids play it.
That's true.
On the Wii, which, you know, on the Switch, I should say, I'm sorry, you know, that's like baby's first console at this point.
That is true.
It's handheld, it's portable, it has all of, like, the kids save games, you know, you see, and obviously adults love it too, but their market is definitely more family-friendly and kid-friendly, so,
very true.
You know, that's... What a better way to pull out $7 from mommy's wallet than, Minecraft.
Exactly.
Right? Nah, they know what they're doing.
That is true. I mean, my kiddo, so she's 10. She's just started watching Minecraft videos. And I'm like, what?
Yep.
And she asked me, she's like, when do I get to play? I'm like, not touching my Xbox? But maybe I'll get it for the Switch and maybe.
There you
but
go.
Not my Xbox. No, that's my COD. That's my, you know, Fortnite and everything else on there. And I'm like, no, not touching that one. So, you know, I know we have you here, so I want to ask your opinion, too. PlayStation 5 or Xbox first? What are you, a personal opinion, what do you like?
What do I like?
Yeah, out of those two.
Or, okay.
Of the new one, the PS5 and the Xbox Series X, Q, 7, whatever we want to call it now.
Personally, I think I'm indifferent. Okay. I prefer PlayStation, and this is completely an unfounded opinion, but I feel like PlayStation tends to garner a more adult audience.
Yeah.
So when you're playing PlayStation, like in online lobbies for online games and things like that, you don't, in my opinion, get as often like a full lobby of like little kids, which is not exactly somebody that I want to spend like my relaxed time with in like, you know, a COD lobby.
Guys, I'm just 5 years old playing.
And that's cool, like if he's quiet the whole time. But like when he's screaming obscenities and being raised, like I'm not, that's not why I'm here tonight.
Exactly.
I don't want to be your dad. I got two kids. Like I'm busy already.
Right.
So that, like if it was my personal purchase, probably there. For the store, you know, we're waiting to see essentially like the exclusives to see which one has a more stocked exclusive set that we feel is going to feel better. Okay. And we're just going to buy one or the other. We're not like right now we have Xboxes and PlayStations and it's just a lot to keep up with.
Right.
We don't see a lot of value in having both. So we're just going to streamline and stick with one, I think, when that release happens.
Okay. I mean, since I haven't, I'll be honest, I haven't looked at a lot of the PlayStation exclusive. Is there anything that's kind of making y'all think, well, this might be better or this one might be better? Or right now, it's still just down the middle.
It's, well, yeah. I mean, it's Horizon Zero Dawn. That came out as kind of a surprise. It wasn't something that everybody was following. What's the Red Dead Redemption in like feudal Japan that just came out?
Oh, God. Yeah, I forgot about that one.
Yeah.
Oh,
and that was amazing. Like just watching that game was beautiful. And that's obviously an exclusive title. So we're just waiting to see really what PlayStation has been investing in and they're going to bring out this year. I think it's a lot of things that people may not necessarily know are coming.
Yeah.
And we like that, right? Like,
yeah.
Sure, Xbox is going to get like all the plain Jane stuff that we're accustomed to. But for us, like buying a $60 copy of a game that... Mm. All Xbox players may not have access to, that may be enough of a draw, right? So that's kind of why I said that.
Okay. And then, what's up? Oh, I thought you were saying something. Jerk. So I want to ask you, too. So, you know, PlayStation 5 and Xbox both have their digital-only versions. Again, personal side first. Would you go for the digital one, or are you like, I want my hard disk still?
Man. So I think a lot of people are failing to realize that, like, although the digital version is less expensive, take Call of Duty, for example. That game is, I think, like, right at 180 gigs now. It might be a little bit more than that because I haven't seen, like, what the new season pass is going to cost. If you have a digital console, right, that game is immediately going to take up almost 50% or right around, you know, right around 40% of your space. So right, you get like that game and like four more to put on there.
If you're lucky.
If you're lucky. That's just not a lot of space.
Right.
So, you know, the disc does kind of offload that. Mm-hmm. And just judging by the hardware, and I don't know of them offhand, but I don't recall seeing any like terabyte models, like a terabyte drive.
Is the that Series X does have a terabyte, okay, I believe. The PlayStation is like 800 or something, it's, or 700 something. Like, it's a weird number. It's not even an even number. It's like 800 or 700. Yeah. Something. I'm like, what?
No, I would definitely go drive. And I think they're backwards compatible, if I'm not mistaken.
Xbox is going to have something. PlayStation, I don't think is.
Oh, really?
I think, okay, PlayStation said they were not doing it this round. Interesting. Which was interesting because you have 1, 2, and 3 of your PlayStation and 4. So it's like, why not go backwards? But Xbox is, yeah, the only one I know that's saying, yes, our Xbox One, some 360, and now we're trying to put even regular Xbox games from the, yeah, original system on there, where PlayStation 5 is like, no, we're not doing backwards, wow, compatibility.
Yeah.
But, I mean, it might be a money thing, too, because they might just put a bunch of their stuff on digital and say, hey, buy it for $5 or $10 or whatever. They might do something that route.
Doubt it's going to be $5.
Well, yeah,
they're
but,
try and
you know,
get as much as they possibly can. You're insane if you think that's a...
I can dream.
Yeah, right. It's,
you're just going to keep buying it every time like, you upload it, and then you're like, I'm going to have to...
Right. I can buy another one. Because, like, what? Final Fantasy VII, just, like, the first part of it was, like, $70, wasn't it? It's, like, not even the full game.
Right.
My friend was like, oh, my gosh, I'm buying it. And she was all excited to play it. I'm like, so it's the full game? She's like, no, it's the first act. I was like, how much did you spend? She's like, well, 120. I bought the special edition.
Well, I thought
edition.
It was the full game, but they've changed like the way that it arcs.
Was it? Is that what it was? Because she made it sound like it was just the first act or something like that.
I think their intention is to like extend it, the storyline. So really what you paid for is like the original game with some different scenes. Some things were like extended a little bit, but the idea, yeah, is that it doesn't end with that final.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay, that makes sense then, because I was like, man, 120 and it's not even the full game.
No, yeah, that would have, I think you would have seen a lot more internet backlash.
That's what I thought.
Yeah, no, people, yeah, there would be like Portland rioting and like people rioting over there at Squaresoft or Square Enix.
Yeah, it would just been like, what? I was like, why am I not hearing more about, okay, whatever. But I just remember her playing it. Right? It's like just these, everyone's in the street. When the riot starts, when Final Fantasy VII wasn't the full game and we had to rebuy it.
Yeah. No, people would be livid.
Oh my gosh, yeah. And I kind of agree with you. But I like hard discs. Like, I like having that physical copy in my hand.
Sure. You know? And you can give it to your friends for a little bit.
Exactly. It's like, here, you can play it. I'm good with it. Or you can resell it. And I was like, get my whole 97 cents from GameStop whenever, yep, I return it in.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. And then for us, obviously, like, for the store, having, yeah, to have the full game installed on each one, like as new titles come out, like we just wouldn't be able to keep up with it. You almost, yeah, have to have the disc to be able to like rotate it between the consoles based on who's playing.
Exactly. And then I can imagine, like you said, if you're trying to keep up with like Call of Duty and all the other big games, you're going to fill up digital, yeah, drive in a heartbeat.
You better not like playing more than one video game at a time. That's pretty much all you're going to have on there.
Exactly. And I don't know if you even saw, I think it was Microsoft has their special external hard drive that was like $200 for another terabyte. I was like, really? You're going to gouge me $200 for a terabyte? That's ridiculous.
Like one of like a very nice like terabyte SSD for a computer, you know, you're spending like $140 if you're patient.
Yeah, exactly.
It's asinine. So that's one more reason, you know, PC Master Race.
Exactly. Like I just built my PC not too long ago and I was like, you know, why have I not done this a long time ago again? I was like, I'm now Game Pass, Ultimate Game Pass is on PC, so you can put some of the games on there too.
I don't even want to talk about that software. That is the most painful, arduous, invasive, garbage application.
I feel like I hit a nerve.
Oh my God.
That's how you really feel.
Right?
No, you got it. I'll give you both barrels. It's like,
oh my God, is it
just the management? You know, you have to have, if I'm not mistaken, and I guess you use it
a little bit.
Three applications that you have to be able to play games with your friends. You have to have the store.
I didn't know that much.
You have to have the actual like Xbox Live client, and then there's, yes, a third one to be able to like invite your friends to some of the games.
I didn't know that one because you're right
terrible.
On the first two. Because I remember
terrible.
I downloaded Live and I was trying to download the game. It's like, oh, you have to download this other thing. And I'm like, okay, I'll live with that, but I didn't know about the third one because I don't play with anyone online on that one that I know because they're all like, oh, we're just on Xbox. I'm like, oh, screw it. I'll just hop on Xbox.
Dude, it's
oh, my God.
Gross.
I didn't know it was that
and
bad.
And you can't – I don't think most of them are cross-platform. So you both, ooh, have to own said game on said software. Like if I own it on Steam and, yeah, you own it on Xbox, same game, we still can't play together.
I didn't know that one either.
Also terrible.
Oh, yeah, because I think – what did I download to it? Fortnite, because my Xbox went out on me the other day. Not the other day, like a month ago. And we downloaded Fortnite. I played Fortnite, but I guess Fortnite's across everywhere at this point. Yeah. That was the only one I played with other people.
That was built that way, though. That was like, we knew that was, yeah.
That was just inevitable, essentially. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I don't think, now that you said that, I don't think I played Gears or any of the other ones with them. Now I gotta, I want to play with that.
Don't call me, bro. I'm not helping.
Sam, help me.
Nope.
He's just like, who's this again?
You can go to LFG if you want. Send me the address.
I'll just come by. Be like, I'm done. Screw it. I'm just going to come by. Here you go. That's true. But yeah, I didn't know about that third one. Because yeah, like I was like a month and a half ago, so for some reason, the Ethernet port on my Xbox went out. Like just randomly went out. So I had to send it. So I didn't have an Xbox for like 2 weeks.
Okay.
So I was like using my PC at this point. I was like, oh, cool. Maybe I'll just switch over to PC. And then like, I played for like three games with them, and then I was like, okay, well, I'm going back to my Xbox. It's back. But I still have my PC, but I do all my editing and everything else on it. So I'm like, cool, you know, keep it. So the other thing I wanted to talk about, since you have the cafe and everything, what do you think about esports and this whole COVID thing going on right now? Like, how do you see everything going, or is it affecting esports a lot right now that you can see? I know we're here in San Antonio, and I know I've seen you speak about esports and arena coming to San Antonio, possibly. Is that all, like, slowing down, do you think, or what things going on with all
that?
No,
that's all moving ahead. I mean, that's kind of, like, one of the great things about esports is you can participate in it in any way that, you know, you'd like remotely. You don't necessarily need to be there physically. Mm-hmm. Is it helping the infrastructure from the standpoint of like event hosting and things like that? Like, oh no, that's terrible. Mm-hmm. Jabali out that does CEO, you know, he had to cancel his event. Like a lot of these large scale events that a lot of people make, you know, their livelihood on have had to be shifted. Affect esports as a whole, because everyone can still compete online. I think the only people that really suffer to a great extent are like Super Smash, mm-hmm. because of just the terrible net code. They don't have, you know, necessarily the support from Nintendo and some of the other FGCs that, you know, people prefer to play in person. Mm-hmm. Other than that, I mean, everybody else is still doing exactly what it is that they would be doing otherwise. They're still trending great. I mean, you know, businesses like mine, entertainment business isn't doing great because people have to physically be there to participate. But esports as a whole is doing great. Port San Antonio still moving ahead.
Nice.
They're going to be in construction for, I think, another 2.5-3 years, if I'm not mistaken. Like, that building's not going to be popped up, you know, overnight. And it's still moving here in San Antonio.
It's
just more in the planning phases. So we've got some cool stuff coming up.
Can you, if you don't mind me asking, is there anything you can say? Because I know you know more than I do on this stuff. And so I'm just, if you can't say it, I understand.
I can't.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, we started like an esports nonprofit, the Esports and Education Foundation.
Oh, really?
Yep. So we're recognized by the state. We've submitted for the federal tax exemption, so we can write, you know, receipts for donations and things like that. So we're going to be utilizing that in the coming year to kind of foster, you know, an environment here in San Antonio and bridge the communities from the education standpoint. Mm-hmm. You know, not necessarily just esports as like an entertainment vessel or a competition vessel, but more of like a learning utility, because you can kind of like rope in people from different facets of, you know, the business side of esports into learning skills and getting real world experience with just utilizing the gaming as a vessel.
Nice. Now, I didn't say I was going to talk about this, but I want to throw it out there. The VFW.
Yes.
You did something with them, didn't you? Like whole, you set up their whole thing, I think, right? Or how'd that go?
I did. It went great. So VFW Post 8541. One of my customers, Billy, mm-hmm. His dad is the commander of that post.
Okay.
And, you know, Bill took over that post and, you know, noticed essentially that there was some tonality with the, participants, the people that were coming into this VFW, and it was kind of across the board. Essentially, there wasn't a lot of younger vets that were either being sought out by the VFW or finding the VFW or wanted to participate in what the VFW offers. And, you know, my interpretation, again, was, you know, like a grandpa's old bar. That's the way that I view the VFW, and I think a lot of people shared that. But to Bill, there was so much more that they offer in terms of community support, veteran support, you know, a laundry list of things here in our local city that they've been doing for years and years and years, and nobody knows about it. So he came to me, and, you know, I've had a couple of veterans that come into my store, and you know, they end up on my doorstep because they want to participate in video games, they want a place to hang out, and, you know, sometimes they just want to be around people.
Right.
And I think that's an important part for a veteran that, you know, has just finished his tour, or whatever the case may be, of kind of like reacclimating slow into the civilian life, because it's not an easy transition. I can't say I understand that. I just know that that's something that, you know, they struggle with. And, you know, Bill essentially was coming into the store one day because he had sponsored an event. We got on the subject of like gaming and esports, and he wanted to understand. He was just asking me questions. Mm-hmm. And long story short, you know, it started to kind of resonate with him, the things that I was saying, in terms of, well, yeah, it's entertainment to a great extent, but it's also, you know, therapy for people sometimes when they're just having a hard time or they need to decompress, whatever the case may be. And I think it was at that moment that it really clicked. He's like, yeah, like, you know, when he did 2 tours in Iraq and 1 in Afghanistan, if I'm not mistaken, and I'm sure I'll get corrected with a text message after this is aired. But he was a special forces operator, and it didn't matter how far out he was, you know, these soldiers were finding time when they weren't on patrol to decompress by utilizing gaming. You know, they would huck out their Xboxes or utilize some of the infrastructure that was already there at these, you know, FOBs to just play Halo against each other or play Madden against each other. And for them, that was an opportunity to not worry about the mission at that time, because that wasn't their prerogative. It was their time to decompress, and they could actually escape it for a little bit. They could communicate with people that were back home or whatever the case would be. So he wanted to find a way to kind of bring that to the VFW. Not necessarily an easy thing, but we kind of formulated a plan to build out a cyber cafe under the roof of the VFW to provide that as essentially a service, in hopes that younger veterans would see it and be, you know, inclined to come in and explore the VFW and give them a second shot. So he's trying to take that image that we talked about earlier and kind of cast that into the future, so that people can see what all the VFW does and what they're capable of, and that their ultimate mission isn't just to serve older veterans, it's to serve all veterans.
Exactly. Well, that makes sense. I mean, I loved when I saw you in that story, dude. I ended up reading that. I was like, dang, I'm so happy for Sam. I saw that. I was like, that's amazing, because like, I come from a small town. I've ever told you. I'm Alice, Texas. You know, it's about 2 hours south of here. And that's...
I jumped through that on the way up from the coast, yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. You went to Corpus or...
Yeah.
Yeah. You're going to drive right by it. So, you know, it's either oil field, you get out, like come San Antonio, or you go military. So a lot of the military guys are still down there. And
right.
When I went to visit the VFW, because I'm actually part of a film, I did a shoot, and yeah, it's Grandpa's Bar. When you walk in, it's just like old guy sitting there. Nice guy, but it's just like old man, like, hey, want a beer? And I'm like, no, I'm here to film because we're filming. I'll probably drink later, but it's like, it's what it reminded me of. You're right. There's a pool table in the back, and that's kind of like all they got. So I'm glad you're bringing that, you know, to those our veterans here. That's amazing, dude.
You figure the older veterans are starting to move out, or, you know, starting to move on, you know, but you got a lot of the newer veterans starting to come in, and you're right, they do need a place to decompress, to socialize, to, you know, talk with your buddies. It's like you get together with your friends, and it's a good way to, like, express, you know, something's going on, something's wrong. It's a good way to catch, you know, the issues before they actually become bigger issues. You know, and I've known a lot of vets that, you know, they go to their local bar, their local VFW, and, you know, they communicate with people that understand them, you know, and that they open up. It's a lot easier for them to open up to somebody who's been there.
That's the same experience. Yeah, absolutely. And that's absolutely his mission, right? His hope is that, you know, it'll give them at least a place to be where he can essentially engage them, with suicide rates being so high.
Oh gosh,
anything that they can do to try and bring them back into the fold and put them around, you know, people that understand that life experience and can be compassionate is definitely, you know, something that he's willing to double down on. And you say that with the efforts. So the VFW is still absolutely, you know, the VFW for the people that have built it. He didn't take anything away from them. He just, it is, absolutely. So he dedicated a small portion that really wasn't being utilized anyway. We've retrofitted it and made it look really sharp, put in new tiles, some LEDs, a bunch of computers.
It looks beautiful. Those pictures, man. I saw those and I'm like, that I want to go there now. check it out. Send my buddies out there.
And again, you know, this also raises like community awareness. You know, people see it and, you know, hey, let's have a community party, you know, for our vets. You know, you can throw it at a VFW. Yeah. I mean, because they also rent out the halls.
So he's redoing that hall as well. So they have a banquet hall. It's like 4,000 square feet, you know, that looked like everything else. If we're being honest, it's an older building.
Square, white walls, white floors.
Well, I wish they were white walls. They were like, you know, that weird like 70s, 80s off tan beige. And so, you know, he came to me and he's like, you know, help me pick colors. And I gave him my recommendation for some like neutral tones that make it look a little bit brighter. And They've done an amazing job. I mean, it looks, it on one side, you know, you go in through the right side of the building because it's a big U. You have the traditional, like, you walk through the security door and all of the accolades are on the walls. You have pictures of all of the veterans and their members, some past, some still there. And it, you know, it honors the people that have essentially built that VFW from the ground up. Yeah. And then you go through the left side through my Land Center and it's a completely different world. I mean, it doesn't smell like smoke. It doesn't look like it's a VFW. You're right. Really walking into something entirely different. So
that's amazing, dude.
Kind of.
Right?
Yeah. Pause bar to like the new club.
Exactly.
That's right.
That's really cool, man. And, you know, I'm glad you're doing that. That's freaking amazing.
Thanks.
Man. It really, really is. So I also want to ask you, so what got you into gaming, too? Because, like, I know you're my guest co-host right now, but I want to ask you, because, like, we never sit and talk about this. So what got you into, like, I wanted my own my cyber cafe. I want to be a gamer. What makes you game, dude? Like, what makes you geek out, I guess, in a sense?
Okay.
As I hit this wall, like, the second time I've done this today.
Elbowing the Hulk, bro.
Look, the Hulk and me have issues right now. I do not like you, Bruce Banner.
I like Bruce Banner. He's real strong. I don't want to mess with that guy. Yeah, probably the last of, unless there's Superman, because I feel like
he's right behind you.
Yeah, he's cheating. He's got like all the crazy stuff. Some rock weakness.
I mean, we just got to throw a rock at him, right? And we're good. Just like, here.
Just find it somewhere in space.
Call Lex Luthor. Just call Lex. Hey, man, you got some kryptonite on you? Or Batman. Batman always has kryptonite on him.
That's true.
Hey, Superman's coming at me. He just went evil. Batman will believe you because he already thinks that Superman's going to do it eventually. That's so true. He's like, oh, I'll take him out.
Then you got to have a line to Batman. And it's not like everybody has that.
That's a good point.
Imagine how much damage Superman could do before Batman could, like, rally.
That's true.
Right?
Before you
get a hold of him. Right. Like, nah. Yeah. Like, we're talking apocalyptic levels of destruction before, like, he's, like, in his little,
he's got to pull his spandex on and everything.
Yeah, nah. We're all dead.
Where did I put the kryptonite?
Nah, he just picked up, like,
Robin,
the moon and
where's
it.
The kryptonite, Robin? I forgot where I put it.
Or just move the moon, like, closer to the Earth.
Oh, God.
And just stay in space, and we'd be screwed anyway. Like,
that's true.
Not
Superman takes us out real quick.
Yeah, no.
But Batman's better somehow, you know. Batman always beats him some way. At least that's what all the Batman fanboys. I'm attacking all the Batman fanboys today. So they'll yell at me in the comments later, I'm sure.
I'm a Marvel fan, so don't bring me into this. Y'all can have that. Hey.
See, my Spider-Man is right behind you, over your head. Oh, and that's my boy right there, is Spider-Man. You got that one, and then you got 20. I don't know if you can see it on camera. The 2099 Spider-Man. I don't know if you ever saw that.
Some fancy stuff.
Yeah, Frank did a good job. I will always give Frank props on that.
Just straighten up.
He's like, let me fix this. But yeah, right. Yeah. It just falls. So yeah, but what got you into gaming? Was it, what was your first game? Let me ask you that. Actually, that you played.
Like first game, like the first game I can like remember playing.
Yeah, because mine was Super Mario. I know that from the Super Nintendo age, and I think we're not far in age, me and you.
No, we're not. But the way that I was introduced to gaming was significantly different, I think.
Oh, yeah?
So I was actually introduced to video games. It was the Sega, for sure. And I'm pretty sure it was Sonic. But, you know, actually before that, I don't think I had a Sega before I was introduced to the PlayStation. So I grew up, like, relatively poor. Video game, like, I have two older brothers. They're 14 and 16 years older than I am.
Oh, wow. That's
right.
So, wait, seriously, they're 14? So,
yeah.
Only reason I comment on that, my brother is about 13 to 14 years older than me, and my sister is 18 or 19 years older than me. Okay. That's why I think it's just funny that you say that, because my siblings are about the same.
Right. So I grew up with brothers, but also as an only child, because the
difference.
Gap is too huge.
Yeah, it was like, we don't want to mess with you. You're like 5, and I'm like 20 now at this point. So, no.
Yes. Yep. So they, you know, way back when you used to be able to rent consoles. So you used to be able to rent the PlayStation from Blockbuster. And they did that, and they showed me, man, I couldn't remember the name of the game. It was almost like Star Fox.
Okay.
But for PlayStation 1. That was the first game that I remember playing and then like being into that. And then like, you know, I kept asking my mom like, oh, can we rent this? Can I have that? And then I would later end up getting a Sega for my birthday. Mm-hmm. But they probably showed me the PlayStation when I was like 5.
Yeah. Okay.
So, at you know, growing up, super poor, mostly an only child out in the hill country of Texas. Like before video games, it was like, all right, well, I'm going to go roll around in the forest with a slingshot. Or like my brothers used to play this game because my brothers and my dad golf and I don't, where they would drive golf balls like out into our property.
Mm-hmm.
And I would play like Easter egg hunt, which was really like, I would go retrieve the golf balls and they'd give me a nickel for everyone I found.
So you're a
fetch. Right?
Yeah. I prefer not to call it fetch, but it was definitely fetch. I was just paid to play fetch.
There you go.
So
as long as they didn't try to hit you while you were out there with the golf ball.
I mean, there was, not with golf balls, but there was a fair share of abuse, I'm sure. I remember, being stuck in trees. Like, they would just pick me up and put me in them and, leave me there. And then mom would have to come out and get me because I was too little.
Yeah.
But, yeah, so for me to go from, playing with toys and, occasionally hanging out with, the one friend I had at the time because nobody wanted to drive all the way out to Helotes, then there was, video games. And it was just, it was, this moment. And I fell in love, right? Because it was something that, just captivated me for obvious reasons. Then it was on to, Sega and the consoles. And my brother would... I think he was still living at the house. He was probably, maybe 18, 19, 20, somewhere in there.
Yeah.
And I caught him playing EverQuest, which was, the first...
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah.
That game.
So I got introduced to EverQuest when I was, 8. And I, I just wanted to be whatever. I wanted to do whatever my brother was doing.
Yeah.
So I would watch him play this game. And, for me, again, the graphics and these are real people because he would kind of, explain it to me. Yeah. I was enamored with that idea. I think that was mostly, maybe even because there was nobody around me as a kid. I didn't have, any playmates or anybody to talk to. And there was a way to, be around other people. So then, by 10, I would have, my own computer.
Oh, wow.
And I would be playing EverQuest. So that was pretty much the end of...
social life.
Whatever else I was supposed to be in life, it was just cut short there, and I was set on this path.
This man's gonna be a neuroscientist.
He's gonna like video games. that's all we got. Yep.
That makes sense. I mean, that's funny though. How you say you live in Helotes and no one wanted to drive out there. Mine was the opposite. We lived in town, but all my friends lived
on the outside.
So it was we don't want to drive in town because Alice is not even 20,000, I think, right? Something like that. So it's no one want to drive in town because they're all on their ranches and stuff. Nah, we want to go do all this. No, I just want to play games.
And Helotes, back then was different than Helotes now. Some people are probably really? That's in town? There was nothing between, Helotes and 1604. There was no HEB. We had, a Handy Andy in Helotes. And the next, HEB was all the way down on Gilbo. So, it is what it is.
Exactly.
It was far then. Yeah.
Yeah, now people are like, oh, you're in Helotes? I'll be there in 30. It's whatever. You're like... What?
I guess they drive more than I did, or my mom did. I guess I don't know.
Right, that's me now. Now my mom, when she comes up in town, she's like, go to the store. It's 15-minute drive. She's like, that's too far because she's used to in Alice, everything's minutes from your house,
right?
Because that's where she lives, and it's that's too far. I was like, mom, it's a 15-minute drive. It's no big deal. No, that's too far, honey. You can just no, don't worry about it. I'm like, I'm leaving now. What the heck do you need? So, but yeah, that's cool though. You got an EverQuest though. I mean, I forgot all about that game.
Played that
honestly.
For years. It was the first 3D MMO. So you had Ultima and some MUDs before that.
Yeah.
But yeah, EverQuest was, they called it EverCrack for a reason. Oh, I think relationships were lost, jobs were lost because of that game. That was a bear.
It was. Cause I remember EverQuest 2, I think when I was in college or something like that. And I remember a lot of my college friends were we're still playing this one. I'm like, and I remember the first one came out, and we were all the same age. We were all roughly about the same age at that time, 19, because it was my sophomore year of college, and they were still playing it. And I'm like, dang.
Can't cut it, man.
No, you really can't. I mean, it took me a while just to get away from Guild Wars and World of Warcraft. Yeah. I was on those for a long time.
Sure, yeah.
And I was like, no, I need to meet a woman somehow. I need to leave these games.
I need to do something else.
Exactly.
Yeah, soaks up some time.
So what do you play now, then? Anything, or you just kind of, because I know you have two kids. You just had a kid recently, so, right?
Yeah, I got a temp. I have a little, what are they calling them? COVIDonial?
Oh, yeah.
Or whatever.
Something,
I forget the term for a baby born during COVID. So he was born right before lockdowns. He's 10 months old now. What do I play? Rust, Dota 2, Escape from Tarkov, a little bit of Call of Duty every once in a while.
Yeah. How's Escape from Tarkov? I've seen a lot of gameplay on it, but I haven't played it yet. It looks frustrating.
How is it? It's terrible. It's a terrible experience for everybody involved, but I think that's what drew me to it.
Yeah.
Playing games for as long as I have and owning a land center, Call of Duty's kind of all the same.
It is.
You go to other shooters, they're kind of all the same. Overwatch did some cool stuff, but at the end of the day, once you've played enough shooters, they're all very similar. Tarkov added a lot of punishment to that experience.
That's what I've seen. That's what I'm like, do I want to get into this?
Not if you don't have time. So I have a few hours at the end of the night that I play. So, I can't really, or if I'm working at the store, sometimes I'll play, but it's each round soaks up anywhere from 10 to 30 minutes. So you're playing a game of League and it's only one little tiny round that you're really not accomplishing that much in the whole grand scheme of Tarkov. So, yeah, it's I wouldn't recommend it, but I would recommend it. It just depends on how sadistic and morbid you are, like how much you enjoy hurting yourself.
That's me in a nutshell, but at the same time,
maybe
I'm like,
it's right up your alley.
It might be, but with all the editing I do, I'm like, do I have time?
I would. Nah, not to like get in it. To learn it, you got to like chuck some time. And really? So like, yeah, I got into it when, like during COVID when, you know, the kids were around and my wife was, you know, like hanging out and we were kind of just doing the shelter in place.
Right.
So yeah, I had some time to invest. But I don't know that I would have stuck with it had that not been the case.
Exactly. No, I got you. Well, cool. Well, I do thank you for coming here, man. We're going to go ahead and cut this one because it's already hit 45 minutes. I'm trying to keep these shorter now. This is because we were hitting an hour.
We didn't even get like halfway through this, did we?
No, we got through all of it. We just like flew through it, I think.
Did we?
Yeah.
All right.
I mean, unless I miss them, possible. That's my nature. But I do want to thank you again. I really appreciate you coming out, Sam. Yeah. I really enjoy talking to you and just sitting here and chilling and finally get to just relax with you and just talk. Where can people find the cafe? Like, what's the website for y'all or all that?
Oh, lfgcybercafe.com. You can hit us up on the socials too. It's at lfgcybercafe. 5500 Babcock Road if you're like old school and just want to see where we are physically. So we're right around the corner from you.
Yeah, we're not far from here.
Yeah.
So cool. Well, go check them out, guys. Go support local businesses. If you're already in San Antonio, please go support local businesses. I'm a big advocate for that. And again, thank you, Sam, for being here. Thank you all for watching and chilling with us today. Remember, go check out youtube.com, official GYGO, Facebook as official GYGO as well. All of our social media pages, Instagram, all that. And all of our videos up there. And again, Get Your Ghost On is going to be up there. Again, this week, Victoria Black Swan Inn comes out on Friday. Our aftermath videos come out on Saturday. Next week should be Donkey Lady Bridge for Get Your Ghost On, I believe. I think that's what I said. I think that's what I'm doing next. I think I'm editing. I don't even know what I'm editing anymore at this point. And of course, you know, next week, hopefully we'll have another guest in the house with us until Robert somehow gets out of, you know, gets back into his blood contract that we made him sign to be here because you're supposed to be here, Robert. And I hope you watch this. But anyway, guys, get your geek on and you'll have a great night.